So let me give you the proverbial 2-minute overview of what we're going to do today and why, how this is going to work. You all know you've all been doing the SDA DLMI training for about a year and a half now. Carrie and Mike, who you both know, and with Schroeder Center and all of you as a partner, and Ron, the Department of Ed, as a partner, we submitted what's called short duration, low cost evaluation research grant. Because you remember when we started this, we talked about that in year two or three, we were going to introduce Who's Future anyway. We wanted SDLMI to start and then do Who's Future after that. So what this grant does is that it actually provides an opportunity to really sort of look at data. It gives these guys a chance to develop an online data system, which you all used and loved at this point in time, right? It's a wonderful thing. So the way this will work, we divided the districts into group one and group two. And I think all of you got an email. The coaches of these and your special ed directors got a long email from me explaining all of that and how that works. You are part of group one, which essentially means that you are being trained in this future, this one. Mike will maybe talk briefly about the difference between the original version and the attainment version. Several people in this room pushed feverishly to have the attainment version of what we used, and so we decided to use that. So what will happen fundamentally is that you will be trained in this with the assumption that you will then implement it in the spring. Districts that are in group two will be trained in the most future sometime in the fall, I would assume, and then they will implement it next year. And what will happen is that there'll be a comparison between, for this year, using the data you already collected, nothing new for you, but that looks at the difference between SDLMI and Who's Future versus SDLMI. So that's the proverbial deal. What's going to happen this morning, Mike's going to talk for a bit. Then we're going to break. Primarily the reason we're going to break is we're going to give out stuff after Mike talks. And for those of you I didn't talk to yet, what we have done, essentially, there's an introductory teacher's kit. And we bought one of those for every two teachers, because they're about $130, $140 each. And we bought a workbook for every kid. Those were like $30 each. So fundamentally, when we break, somebody from your district, the coach, if the coach is here, can come up and tell us we have seven teachers, that's however many you have, 8,000 kids, there aren't that many, and we will give you this stuff. And I know some districts, because we did this, the reason we did voting in the afternoon was so that your special ed directors could hire less subs. Several of them thank me for that, which is good. So I know some of you are coming, some of your district teachers are coming this afternoon, so just let us know that we'll have a file for them as well. All right, everybody cool? You can't sit back there.
We can't?
No, you have to sit right here.
Sure.
Or right here.
Do you know they make them park everyone behind the dorms?
Yeah, and I apologize for Rhode Island College Police Force, but they do not let us, they used to let us park anywhere, but trying to control parking now, they make everybody park behind the dorms. Usually when I introduce these things, I say, Rhode Island College is concerned about your physical health, so they want to make sure you get your exercise for the day.
Especially when nice enough
I lied.
Today.
It's one of those things. So having said that, you all know Mike and Carrie.
Do you mind if I say
that? Weymeyer, Carrie Sherman.
I have to be able to work.
You've been here before during the talk, so let me turn this over to Mike.
It was funny, funny.
How are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I missed you.
That's good to see. See, it's Rhode Island.
Do I need to use the mic?
I continue to be impressed that everyone knows everyone in Rhode Island.
We love him. How long
Good morning. So I have to start off by saying that both Carrie and I got whacked by some
cold thing last week. We've been traveling too much. So we're going to give it 100%, but that's about 80%, I think, of what we have. So hopefully my voice will last. We're going to talk a lot about whose future is it. I'm going to provide just a little bit of background information, I think, just because we have some time. So what you probably remember is that the 1990 reauthorization of IDEA, which actually changed the name to IDEA, included for the first time transition requirements. Things have changed a little bit, but basically when a kid turned 16 now, it was 14 then, you had to talk about transition-related goals at the IEP meeting, any kid receiving special education services. The definition stated that such transition services must be based on student interests and preferences as well as student needs. So there was this introduction of language around student interests and preferences. And then the language in the law says that students must be invited to their IEP meeting if transition goals are to be discussed. That set off a series of federal initiatives generally just became sort of known as the student involvement mandates. It's actually a pretty weak mandate, but you know, it makes a lot of sense, right? I mean, the reason that some of the work that we've done, well, almost all of the work we've done around self-determination emerged out of the same era. So that was two kind of things coming up at the same time. And in part, it was because in the mid-80s, so IDEA, Public Law 94-142, was passed in 1975 and had to be fully implemented by 1978. So we had just under a decade of kids actually receiving free appropriate public education by the mid to late 80s. And there was a sense that there were still things that were lacking in terms of students achieving anything. So the Office of Special Education Programs funded a whole series of follow-up and follow-along studies to study how well students were doing once they left school. And those started coming out around the late 80s and the early 1990s. And what it showed was there had been some progress, but there was still a long way to go. And we know that to be the case today. The feds then later funded two consecutive 10-year studies, the National Longitudinal Transition Studies, 1 and 2. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but these were 10-year longitudinal, you know, studies. Pretty highly powered that followed kids along for a series of years after they left high school to take a look at how kids were doing. And again, you know, with each of these, we're making progress, but we still got a ways to go. So one of the outcomes of these early 90s focus on transition and student involvement and self-determination was that there emerged a number of programs and packages and processes that focused on how do we get students involved in the IEP and what does that look like, and you know, what can teachers do, what can district level people do. I'll talk a little bit about a couple of them, but we were funded in the early 90s through not even a special education initiative. It was funded through the Women's Educational Equity Act program, The WIA program is part of Title IX, which everyone knows from sports, right? Equity in sports. But it also says, it also has, on and off over the years, it has discretionary funds to create processes and materials that address gender inequity. And we noticed pretty early on in our work around issues of self-determination that girls and young women were particularly, I will say, in need of the kinds of interventions around goal setting, problem solving, and decision making. Boys and young men were oblivious to, they tended to have this fantastical idea that everything was going to be wonderful, whereas girls and young women actually understood that things were not good and they needed to, so we actually developed Whose Future Is It Anyway? To address gender equity issues, although it was always intended to be used by everyone. I don't know how much of that really remains in the current version. So we developed and did some initial research on this, and I know that the Whose Future Is It Anyway materials are up on the Sherlock Center website. It's a PDF. The idea was that teachers. So one of the things that I wanted Whose Future to be as different from other packages that were out there was I wanted the student to choose what her role would be in the eventual meeting. Because everything else, all the other packages were geared toward the student chairing the meeting and running the meeting. And that's all well and good, but I felt like some students may not want to do that. But that, so there's the process is intended that students go through and learn about transition and you know, IEPs and meetings and about setting goals and about making decisions and about all these things that would enable them to play a meaningful role in their transition planning process. And the only thing we quote require out of the process is that a student must have a goal that they have written that they take to their IEP meeting. You know, so that's sort of the minimal level of what we want folks. But, you know, whatever role the student chooses and desires to play is what the teacher, the facilitator will support. So, so the original package, the full-blown thing, is 36 lessons. The idea was you would do one a week through the entire year leading up to the student's IEP. So start it right after the student's IEP, go for the full year, and then for the next IEP, the student would be ready to take this stuff into their IEP meeting. We've always distributed it freely because we couldn't get it published. you know, it's been sort of, we updated it in 2004 because the IDEA reauthorization had changed some of the things, and we needed to change some things that were in the overview of transition services. We made them more generic. If IDEA is ever reauthorized again, we won't have to do much to it, if anything. But then, and we have, I'll share a little bit of research. We have conducted randomized trial studies that show that students who are engaged with Whose Future Is It Anyway enhance self-determination, greater transition knowledge, greater self-efficacy for their capacity to engage in this. And so we know that we have evidence that it has impact. Right after we published those studies, Attainment Company contacted us and said, we're looking for evidence-based practices that might be something we could publish. And I had been interested in years in getting more of a universally designed version. The drawback of the original, one of the drawbacks of the original, was that it was paper, pencil, you know, based. and students who didn't read or didn't read well really required a lot of support to go through it. Now, I've seen teachers take it and use it with kids with real extensive support needs, just mark it up. I mean, it's, you know, it's like any other process. You know, nothing is really out of the package ready for most of the students we work with, so it provides a framework. But so when attainment came to us, I said, you know, that would be great, and what we really want is something that infuses some universal design so students can actually do more of it in terms of self-directing their learning. And so over the course of about a year, they went back and forth with us. They immediately decided that 36 lessons was out of the picture. And so they narrowed it down to 17. It's been a while since I've dealt with this version, so we've been relearning it. What you'll see is things get distributed later. So the core is a student workbook that is intended for the student to use. And it's replicated on the CD so that the student can work through this workbook on a PC or, I assume, Mac. Well, it's loaded on your Mac, so it works. There's an instructor's guide that is the teacher's guide to how to support students through that. And then there's a workbook that the students can use that's also these forms. These are just the activities that they're referred to from the student handbook. So they usually have some activity when they go through a lesson in the handbook. These are also available in PDF, and you can print out as many as you need. So those are the components. We've tried to get funding to move most of the workbook online into an app kind of based things where students could do and store things online rather than the paper pencil stuff. But so far we haven't been able to get funding for that. That's what we're going to talk about today, and Carrie will be going through the details of the how-to around the actual curriculum and intervention. I want to talk a little bit about some of the what we intended with Whose Future, as I've mentioned, was to try to engage students in learning as independently as possible. A lot of our work we really talk about, you know, the goal isn't that students are completely independent. The goal is that students are provided the support they need to be as engaged as possible in the process. And we know from research, and I'll show you a little bit of that, that students who are engaged in their IEP meetings who are provided instruction that enables them to participate do indeed participate more. It changes the perceptions of the adults in the room about what the student can do. Students, we know from other research that students that self-set goals are more motivating for students to achieve than other set goals. And of course, the IEP process is a handy process through which to learn problem solving and, it's all about engaging in social interactions and self-advocacy and decision making and goal setting. So it's a context in which students can practice skills that enable them to be more self-determined and can learn and acquire skills. And I think it can be an empowering process. I'll share a story. We moved to the Kansas side of the Kansas City metro area in 1999 when I started at KU. My youngest son was just about to enter kindergarten, and my oldest son was entering third grade. And we moved to a district that had embraced this idea of student involvement in planning, but for all students. And so annually, there were two parent-teacher meetings, one in the fall and one in the spring. The parent-teacher meeting in the spring was student-led. And what that meant was there was a two-page piece of paper that the teacher would work with each student to fill out, and it said, you know, it's a very simple process. It said, you know, this year in, you know, fill in the blank, math, I was good at, and then stuff they were good at, and they pulled out their portfolio, and they showed what they were good at, and then, and you know, I still need to work on X, Y, Z. So, but they didn't start that till first grade. And so the second semester of my older son's third grade year, my younger son saw that he was able to do this, he was allowed to do this. And we didn't really pay too much attention to it. I mean, I was kind of surprised. Nobody in the district knew that we had our own student involvement packet. They didn't know me from Adam, so. So, you know, I thought, well, this is pretty cool. And, my older son was pretty excited about that. And, you know, it was, you know, I've seen similar where you just do a PowerPoint telling what you do well and this kind of thing. So when my younger son moved into first grade the next year and they got into the spring and began planning for this thing, he was so excited. And the night before this meeting that he was to lead, we couldn't get him to sleep. I mean, he was so excited. And I thought, you know, if we did this with all kids, and particularly with kids with disabilities, beginning early on where it's about them and not about what they can't do, their deficits, we wouldn't have problems by the time we get to high school where kids don't want to be engaged and involved in that. So, you know, I think it can be a very empowering process for students. And I've talked to students all over the country who have, you know, again, various forms. Teachers have done different things put in place ways that students can lead their IEP. In fact, one of the things I try to do is when I'm in a high school, doing training or something, I often ask the students if they know what their transition goals are. Now I understand that high school students, you know, I've parented to high school and now older students, you don't always get the answer even if they know it. But you know, by and large, you can sort of tell because you know students will go on and on about these things. And you know, the point of the student involvement language, the point of the self-determination stuff was that what we found out from that 80s research was that a critical piece we were missing was the student. And so that's, you know, that was the impetus for the title, Whose Future Is It Anyway? You know, it's the student's future. Attainment decided they were going to drop anyway. I don't know why. Probably grammatically incorrect or something. So it's about giving students a voice in the process and engaging them. And through the process, students learn some critical skills that will enable them to become more self-determined. I use the term student-directed, so let me just be clear about what we mean by student-directed, because You will recall, I hope, from the trainings around the SDLMI and the stuff we did earlier, being self-determined is not about doing things yourself, right? It's about becoming a causal agent, making things happen in your own life. Determinism is the philosophical doctrine that all events and actions are caused. So it's really self-caused action versus other-caused action. So it really has nothing to do with doing things independently, right? It's about making things happen in your life. I've used the comment before, but we've known for 25 years that problem behavior has a communicative intent. And if you look at what people are communicating, it's almost always related to personal preference and volition and will. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that with you. I don't want to do that right now. I don't want that. You know, I don't want to eat that. It's all about expressing your preferences, obviously. And what PBIS does is that it changes the game and it focuses on making such problem behavior irrelevant by providing better opportunities and how to ask for and to get and advocate for what you want, and taking a look at what it is that's through functional antecedent assessment. So whose future is it? The end audience at a very real level is the student. And the original process had a student packet like this, not as professionally well done. It was whatever icons Word was allowing me to use at that era. And then a small coach's guide, we called it, that was for the facilitator, the teacher, which, you know, you've got both of those. But, you know, the student was placed in the center of the process and then provided whatever support the student needed to be as engaged as the student could be, okay? So, you know, we use the language of retaining control over the process. We're working, much as we do with the SDLMI, to keep the student at the center and in control of his or her own learning with whatever supports are necessary. And, you know, for some students who have quite extensive support needs, that just may mean that you're working really hard to pay attention to what a preference might be so that you can use that in planning. So it will vary a lot according to the student. But and of course, you know, IEP meetings historically have not been very student-directed, right? I mean, it's been a few years since I've been in an IEP meeting, but I'm guessing it hasn't changed all that much, you know, as a teacher and as other roles. You know, it's a process that for far too many students is disempowering, and what people talk about is what he or she can't do and where they failed, right? I think I probably told this story when we were here last year doing some training, but it's worth repeating. A text from the 80s, Lipsky and Gardner's text on inclusion, talked about, even then, looking at transition programs, that if we did college the way that we do most transition programs, remember the story, you know, you would take a battery of tests before you started college, and we would identify the 10 things that you do worst, your personal suck list. And then we would spend 4 years getting you a little bit better at the things that you do worst. And, you know, I mean, it's a broad brush, admittedly, but you know, there is a grain of truth in that. We focus on deficits because part of our role is to remediate and to, you know, and we've got to, you know, and so it's a fine line, but I think that line is too often crossed where it's just all we talk about. And Lipsky and Gardner says we ought to do transition like we do college. And how do we do college? Well, you've got a list of the 10 things that you like a lot, you think. Things that you like. You got a list of the 10 things that you are good at. And somewhere on that I like it and I'm good at it list, there are going to be some things that interact. And then you're going to spend 4 years getting a lot better at those things. And I think that's what high school, particularly in 18 to 21, ought to look like for students with disabilities. We ought to be focusing on strengths-based, what students like, what they're good at, and really working to get them better at those things so that they can live better lives. In fact, that exercise was in the original version of Whose Future, the 10 things you like and the 10 things you don't like. I honestly can't remember whether it made the cut for that, so you'll have to tell me if it's in there when you go through it. So again, the point here is that it doesn't really matter how much the student can do by or for themselves, right? It is about the students being supported to engage in the process to the maximum degree possible. Again, you may recall the principles that Lou Brown and his colleagues introduced for teaching students with extensive support needs back in the late 80s. There were two of them that were particularly important, and they're relevant here. One is the principle of maximal participation, and that one says people with severe disabilities have a right to participate as much as possible in activities, in actions that impact their daily life, right? So we all know that in the busyness of a day and, you know, whatever else, it's often easier to do something to or for a student who's slow at it, or maybe they can only do one of the 10 steps, and we think, why bother? You know, I'm gonna have to do the other 9 things for them. But that kind of flies in the face of empowering people to be maximally involved in their life. And when we go down a road where everything is just done for people, we create very dependency-creating circumstances, which, you know, we've had a word for that in special education since the 1970s. Ed Ziegler and others talk about outer directedness. So if you'd have done your special ed training when I did in the 70s, you would learn that you know, people with intellectual disability are outer directed. And what that meant was they were waiting on somebody else to prompt them so they wouldn't initiate actions on, you know, you knew that a student could do something, and yet they never initiated it. They always waited on an adult to prompt them to do that. And it's really prompt dependency. I think Ziegler and them were wrong in making that a characteristic of the person. It's a characteristic of the environments that we created that lead to greater dependency. And so we want to engage students to the maximum degree possible. So, you know, so even with the online-based version, there will be students who need quite a bit of support. You're gonna have to use your magic as a teacher. I mean, if you're working with kids with more complex support needs, like I said, there's no package that is, you know, immediately and without modification appropriate. You're gonna have to know what the student likes, what they do, how you support them. You know, there's still a lot of teaching that goes into that. So student directed is that we want to maximally engage the student, not equivalent to independent, but that the student's role in this process is that you want to support them to work through as, quote, independently as possible. The technology will help that. The students will be, who otherwise might not be able to go through the print version very independently, will be able to do more through the CD version. So whatever support's in place, complete all the activities and the actions. It was written to try to be humorous to middle and high school students. I don't know how, you know, I wasn't a middle or high school student, but I am sort of adolescent, so I think my sense of humor jives with most high school students. We had to, and there are some inside jokes that nobody ever got. and I think they were, the 2004 revision, they kind of took it, my colleague Susan Palmer and others, they took it and said, why don't we work on this? I think it was their chance to eliminate the things that they saw didn't work. So, you know, we want the student to be engaged, we want the student to have fun with this. It gets students talking about what's in the future, it gets students talking about goals related to vocation and independent living and, you know, all these other things. It should be a natural part of a process. I've often had a parent say, well, you know, what can I do? And I think it's good parenting too. You can pick up the same material and go through with your son or daughter and have conversations about what they want, what they want out of life and what they do. So it should be fun for the student, and hopefully you will see that. It's my impression. Yeah, I mean, students like talking about themselves, right? They like it when you talk about them. You like it. They like it when you talk about what they can do. So, you know, I think it is a process that students enjoy being involved in. The teacher's role becomes sort of multifaceted. You're a facilitator in that you're really doing whatever it takes to enable that student to be as involved as possible in the process. So, you know, you're using your wisdom and knowledge to design accommodations and supports, and to know, you know, your creativity to solve problems around what might be a barrier for a student. You know, there are teaching opportunities. So you also play the role of a teacher. Students, I mean, you know, there's a lesson or two on goal setting. Well, students aren't going to become, you know, proficient just from one lesson, right? So there's lots of teaching opportunities. So that role is still there. And then I think a really important one is this one of advocate. I think that, you know, I told the stories about my friend Ray Gagne when I was here last, and you know, one of the things that struck me about Ray's life and his story was that what enabled him to have the courage or just to take a chance or take a risk to move somewhere or to do something different was that somebody told him that they believed that he could do this. They communicated their belief that he was capable and that they would support him. And then they, you know, and I think that's so important, obviously. And so that's a critical role in this. And, you know, I think we have worked with the Whose Future process with every imaginable typology and characteristic of kid you can have. I mean, we've had this thing around since 1995. We worked with, you know, at one point we actually had a project that had implementation going on in all 50 states through chapters of the ARC of the United States when I was there. So, you know, we know that it can support students, even students with the most extensive support needs. Middle school, high school, 18 to 21, we've done it all there. You know, when you're working with middle school students, you're not setting goals that are as specific about employment or living, because, you know, there's still a way to go. But when you get to 18 to 21, those goals probably ought to be getting pretty specific about where to work and what to do. So, you know, this is, we call this a student, I'll call it student self-regulated or self-directed planning, but it's like anything else. The teacher is the pivotal role in this. You know, if left on their completely own, students will have a difficult time working through it. But so I probably talked through all of these. We want students to take a meaningful role in planning for their future. And I use the term meaningful just as a placeholder for whatever it is that the student wants to do and can be supported to do, right? So we're not necessarily talking about that student running her own IEP meeting, but we might be, okay? There may be students that do want to do that. And there might be students that want to have other roles in the process. So we focus on these characteristics of component elements of self-determined action, decision-making skills, problem-solving, negotiation, leadership. You know, there is obviously a focus on the fact that IEP meetings are small group meetings, you know, and there are actions and behaviors that communicate things in small groups that might not be relevant. So we talk about body language. We talk about when you're sitting in the meeting and you're slumped all the way down, what is that communicating? So, you know, those kinds of things. So there's a lot of focus. And then, you know, it's a good opportunity to talk about leadership skills. I don't think leadership skills get talked about very much for kids with intellectual disability because people don't perceive them as being leaders particularly. So a little bit of the research background, just to provide some confidence that these things work. We did a study a number of years ago where we were measuring the degree to which students were involved in their IEP meetings and their self-determination. This wasn't an intervention study. We were just measuring both of those things. We had a whole lot of a list of things to look at what might predict greater student involvement. We were interested in what factors predicted greater student involvement. Students who were more self-determined were more likely to be engaged in their IEP meeting. So student self-determination predicted student involvement, which you would expect, right? So, but just as I think you would expect as well, that relationship went the other way too. That if you engage students in their planning meetings, they become more self-determined. So it's a do loop back in the days of Fortran. Students who are more self-determined will want to be involved in their IEP meeting. Students who are involved in their IEP meeting will become more self-determined. So I think the gist is students just need to be dropped in and done, and they need to be supported to do this. It's going to have beneficial outcomes around issues of self-determination. One of the really the only other student involvement curriculum that has causal evidence of its efficacy is the self-directed IEP, which Jim Martin and colleagues developed out of the same grant era that we developed Who's Future. Some of you may be familiar with it. The self-directed IEP has 11 steps that students learn to self-direct their IEP meeting. It's things like introduce everyone who's at the meeting, identify what goals were you had last year, identify your progress on goals, and a whole step of things that are partly just a function of the process, like introducing people, and partly having them talk about progress toward goals. It was developed mainly for students with learning disabilities and emotional behavior disorders, although I think it could very well be used with kids with intellectual disability, I'm sure has. They did a study, a three-year study of middle, junior high, and high school students with the self-directed IEP. There was increased student involvement. So when you actually get to measure, and Jim and them did a whole series of studies trying to measure student involvement in IEPs, what you find is that parents and teachers talk predominantly during IEP meetings, or school personnel, right? Students tend not to be very engaged. So they found greater student participation once the students had got through the self-directed IEP, and there was a greater probability that what would be discussed would include student strengths as well as their instructional needs and their interests. So by engaging the students, we begin to change the tone of IEP meetings, right? Jim and them did a randomized trial study about a decade ago where they randomly assigned secondary age students to treatment or control group, got this self-directed IEP, and there was a significantly increased percent of time that students talked, started, and led meetings as one of the outcomes of that. So, if we give kids the tool and the expectation that they could do this, they do this. With Who's Future, the first study we did was a sort of to validate the process. We were working with 53 high school students with a learning disability or with intellectual disability. And we found pre and post significant differences in scores of student beliefs about whether they could engage in the process and whether they believed that if they did engage it, it would make a difference. So it changed students' attitudes, as well as greater knowledge about transition-related skills. So they had a better understanding of the process, of what transition was, what kind of skills, and it increased and improved the degree to which they believed that they could engage in the process. We did a randomized trial study of almost 500 middle, high school, and transition age students across multiple disabilities. This was proportionally represented, so the percentage of each type of disability was equivalent to what generally is found in the special ed population. We found a causal positive effect of whose future is it anyway on self-determination. So students who were involved in the process became more self-determined, as well as transition knowledge and skills. So again, just if we do this, benefits are accrued. And then by adding technology in, so I had a doc student who did a study, sort of the version of that she used, we created from an accessible reader kind of program where we took some number of the lessons from the Whose Future and we put it into this audio reader kind of system with some graphics that we ended up actually sending that to attainment. And I think it was sort of, I'll call it the precursor to the attainment version. But all students got Whose Future. Some students got the paper pencil version and they were randomly assigned. The others got the technology version. And the students, all students got benefited, enhanced self-determination, self-efficacy, outcome expectancy for planning. But the students in the technology group benefited even more than the students in the paper pencil group. So it confirms, I think technology can be empowering in a way that's very different from other kinds of supports. Another doc student did a study years ago looking at the use of it. At the time, these were palm top PCs. It was sort of before the era of smartphones, but these were small PCs that ran a Windows tablet version. And it was loaded with a program that you could provide video-based supports and audio. So a student would tap on the screen and it would show a picture of the task, and then there would be an audio that said, now put the silverware there, and then when they're done, they go to the next screen. And the study was looking at this young woman who had, her task was to set up a restaurant table to prepare it for somebody coming in to eat, right? And you think about it, there's a lot of steps on that. You gotta have silverware in the right place, you gotta have glasses and different kinds of glasses. You got to, and then there were 100 and some odd steps to it. Again, I think I talked about this a little bit last time. We looked at the number of prompts she received from her job coach before we started having her use the palm top PC. The average was 350 prompts, basically, it took for her to complete that task successfully. When we introduced the palm top PC, she learned to use it like in two trials, and from then on needed zero prompts. So, particularly young people with intellectual disabilities, and now of course smartphones are just so powerful, you can load that kind of stuff on it. There's so many things we can do. So we know that there is an added benefit to the technology, and I think that's what we'll see with the version you're going to be using. So that's my overview. we thought we would try to minimize the amount of talking we do and maybe maximize your participation more. So maybe at your tables, take a few minutes. We're going to segue, and I think this is where the maybe we even take a break or and.
Yeah, why don't you do this, then we'll take a break, and during the break, we want to give you the Who's Future materials so that in the second half, you can kind of work with those, so we'll coordinate that during the break. But you can do this first. And then we'll take a break.
So just at your tables, think, care, and share about a positive experience or a challenge regarding student participation in the IEP process. What has been your experiences? What has worked? What hasn't worked? I've shared some of my experiences, but they're not necessarily the same as yours. So just take a few minutes and talk about that.
I had a student a couple of years ago that was involved in the unified cheerleading, and you know, she played an active role, and we had one of the gals from the other room. We had a couple of classrooms that were similar. That young lady helped with the makeup, and another gal just came and she was the chair, so we tried to involve them in all different phases, and we were very lucky that we did have one of the parents who used to come to all the games and bring her son. But a lot of the challenges, and even from everything you talked about from the beginning, and I'm sure a lot of my colleagues would agree that parent involvement is very, very tricky. And I think for like my classroom right now, maybe 60% or higher is not the norm. You know,
sure.
There's like maybe 30% that I might get a parent involved, or not involved, but be able to attend, you know, a meeting, mm-hmm. and to be able to speak with them on a regular basis. I can't do that because I have three parents that don't talk English.
Right.
So those are some of the setbacks.
But I think, and of course, that's always the case. I mean, there's never going to be 100% of anything in terms of involvement, whether it's student or parents or, you know, whatever. I have found that I think having something like Who's Future helps formulate conversations with families about what's possible, rather than because you know I know that families are often overwhelmed. The future is not something that they like to think about because you know once school is over, there's no entitlement, there's no you know, and you know, of course, like every other part of society, we have families who are working multiple jobs, and as you say, you know, English isn't their first language. You know, I think among the things we need to do is begin these conversations earlier. I think, you know, what parents learn are what their kids can't do, and they don't really, I mean, I would have thought it would have changed more, but I think it's still true that by and large, by the time parents get to high school, these ideas of work are brand new to them, or they don't have any expectation. They've been told often that their son or daughter probably won't work, right? So I think you know. I think we need to at least begin doing this in middle school and beginning to have these conversations. And part of that conversation is with the family about what's possible, as opposed to you know, these are very real issues. Frankly, it's the same thing as with many of our peers as teachers and educators. That have very low or no expectation that students with intellectual disability can achieve. So it's also maybe conversations with them. So anyone else?
I have a student. Her goal was to go shopping to get a Barry Manilow CD. So she went through the process and she attained the CD. And what was so special about it is when she was listening to it, this is a student who never initiates any conversation. And this is a while afterwards, and she's listening, and right in the middle, she stopped and thanked the person.
And did what?
And said thank you.
I love the specificity of a goal to go shopping for a Barry Manilow CD. What that means is you're paying attention to her preferences and interests because, you know, well, Barry's, I guess, you either love Barry or you hate Barry, right? So well, that's great.
So if it's a Barry Manilow CD, is she 60?
I said anyone that came in school, they would have thought it was my idea.
Others?
Amy, I'm going to make you what you just shared with me.
Oh, thanks, Terry. Well, as most of you, I think we went to the Institute last year, the Transition Institute, and our district kind of, or the high school, I should say, kind of adopted their undetermined.org website, college philosophy, and really went ahead with it with our kids. And our kids are a range and variety of nonverbal to pretty high functioning, and they've all been leading their IEPs and stating what their goals are. And as teachers, we just kind of sit back and have a conversation with parents, but the students really take the lead and introduce everybody and talk about their goals and what they see their future looking like and all of that. So we've been able to, she's had it the most challenging because she's got the nonverbal ones. I have the ones who talk, so it's kind of nice. But it was amazing to see someone who really struggled in communicating for the entire 8 years we've had him, and his last year was able to go to his meeting and really say what he wanted his future to look like.
Yeah. So I've determined.org is a website that Virginia State Department of Education put up a few years ago. Same kinds of things that Whose Future and self-directed IEP do. And that's our experience with this. Our experience is that students do things that you really don't expect them to do, and it provides opportunities for them to express preferences about, not only did the student you were working with be able to achieve, so they got the Barry Manilow CD, wonderful, but they also set and achieved a goal. So they're learning that they can set and achieve goals that are based upon what they want in life, right? And they're learning that they have a voice that can impact things. And those are all really important things to learn. Without any hesitation, I think that engaging students who don't communicate in typical ways, so you just got to work a little harder to figure out how they're communicating, how you engage them, what you do. But again, good teachers can do that, and I'm sure you've done that as well. So
that's probably what's new. So after the high school, we learned about self-determination from the last year. We created a class, so we have a self-determination period that all 23 students are involved in. So basically, I kind of like create a curriculum where they learn about their interests, their strengths, focus on their careers, and develop goals and new skill sets that they didn't know they possessed by creating a goal and reaching that goal.
How do students respond to that? What is their?
They really enjoy the class, and it's really focused on their interests, even though they're all working maybe on the same, like I present the same curriculum, but then it's really individualized to what their interests are.
Yeah. Well, and I was in Spain last week talking to a group of folks who provide support for people with intellectual disability, and they asked, their system, they're sort of at a support system that's still mainly congregate, not large institutions, but large group homes and day programs kinds of things. And schools are still pretty segregated. But so the question was, we work in groups, everything you're talking about sounds very individualized. How do you do that in the context of a group? And the truth is, mostly you're working in the context. I mean, that whole study we did, the first one in 95, we were working with classes of students. So there's some things that across the class every student's going to need and to benefit from. And then you're going to have to kind of personalize some things to make sure that every student is really getting what they need out of it. So, you know, we're moving toward an era of personalized learning, and I think the technology supports enable you to do some group things and some individual things and be able to spread it out so that everyone gets, you know, some time related to what they're doing well. So why don't we take 10 minutes, be back here at about 25 after, and then Tony and Terry are in charge of distribution of all materials. So upon your return, you will be distributed.
So, well, actually, if one person from every district will just come, whoever's in charge, your coach is not here. Back to here.
All right, so everyone is at a table that you guys have at least one of the packets that was wrapped in plastic, right, with all of the materials. Okay. Because really what we're going to do for the next hour and a half or so, I'm going to kind of try to do a relatively quick overview of exactly what these different pieces are and how they go together and how you can use them. And then, just because I know if we released you just to go back to your schools without having the chance to go through some of the materials, practice using them, it's going to be hard to hit the ground running. So we're going to spend some time doing some activities to try to get familiar with what is here, to think about problems we might encounter, and do some brainstorming around it. So everyone should have, in your packet, the three books, and you guys all have extra student workbooks, and then a CD. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about what each of these pieces are. Mike introduced them briefly this morning, but they all kind of fit together and operate together. So the instructor's guide, pretty self-explanatory. This is your guide that kind of gives you tips for each of the 17 lessons and units. It has some different role play activities that you can use and some strategies to implement the lessons. One thing to be aware of, in the front cover of the instructor's guide is a CD. So this CD has a PDF version of the student reader, the student book that the student is supposed to read through. So if you want to, say, project this up on a smart board or use it like for technology with the entire class, you have the entire document PDF'd on here, so you can use it in that way.
That's the student handbook. That's the one that solo.
I'm talking, it has the student reader as a PDF. It also, though, so the student workbook, which is all the lessons for students, all of those, all 49 activities are on the CD, both as a PDF, but also as a Word document that's a fillable Word document. So the students could, if you don't want them to be using the paper and pencil, if they want to do it on the computer, because then you can save it and change it and do multiples of them, because students are probably going to be working on these over time, they can use those fillable Word documents. So like, for example, you could set up a folder on the computer for each student and save a copy of those Word documents in there. So it's kind of thinking about the students you're working with, how you want to do this. Would you rather them have the paper and pencil so they can fill out all the worksheets? So that's why you all have a workbook, because some students are going to benefit from that. But those are all also on the CD here. So start thinking about that, and we'll brainstorm about that as we're kind of thinking about how you might start implementing this in the classroom. What do you think your students are going to prefer? And it may vary by students. The paper and pencil workbook, you've got the PDFs, so you can project those, but then also the fillable Word documents, which are really helpful too. So all of that is on the CD in your instructor's guide. So the instructor's guide is really just for you, no student-specific material in here. You'll find that, again, there's kind of instructional guides for you. They're really brief, like a page to two pages for each of the lessons. So that's a quick read-through for you to do, so you have ideas for how to support the students. There's also one of the very first student lessons is to actually learn and get familiar with an IEP. So it actually tells you that if you can, get students access to their own IEP so that you can actually go through that with them, they can see it.
if that's going to be a problem for whatever reason, in your instructor guide, there's kind of a generic kind of template IEP that has all of the main components that you can also use with students. So you can copy that, pull that out, and use it if there's any concerns or if you need to get permission or whatever to get students access to their IEP. But that's part of the process of helping them get familiar and break those things down. So let me talk a little bit, and feel free if you have questions, because I'm a little bit more familiar with this. I know we're just kind of handing all of this to you, so interrupt me, ask questions, we can go over this multiple times. But so you have the two student pieces. So this is going to be what you use directly with your students. So the workbooks, this is really the activities that students are going to do. They're going to fill in all of these. But the student reader is what's going to give the student the information in the instruction that lets them complete the activities. So you want to be starting with the student reader. So you guys have one paper copy of that in your big packets that you got. You also have the PDF version in your instructor's guide. But what we think is really cool, and I'm going to open it up on my computer and show you how it works, is so the CD that you have, you should all have one copy of this. This is a universally designed student reader, so it replicates exactly what's in the student reader paper version that will actually read all the content out loud to your student. There's different accessibility features built in. There's quizzes that students do. You can set it up for each of your students so that it has different supports for them. So the reason you guys only have one student reader, we didn't give you one of those for each student, is that you can load this on computers and have students be engaging with it in this way. Each CD will let you load it on multiple computers, so if you want to put it on a few computers in a computer lab or in your classroom, you're going to be able to use it for those purposes. But so this CD just has the student reader on it.
Can I also put it on my home Apple?
Yeah, you could, so that if you want to interact with it and practice,
that would
be perfectly fine. So this is kind of that universally designed version. So it replicates the student reader. So again, you kind of have to make decisions in terms of, do you have students that having the paper version is going to be their preference or what's most accessible to them? Or is the online version going to be most useful? I will say that these are both written to be at about a fourth grade reading level, so you have to think about that in terms of the student reading it by themselves. The nice thing too is there's highlighted vocabulary words and other things in the universally designed version that kind of helps students also be learning some of those critical terms that are related. So that's what these components are. So the student reader is the first part. When you're first getting started with students, they'll do chapter one in the reader, and then they'll go to the activities for chapter one in the workbook. And then you'll go to chapter two activities. So it's kind of designed in that way. The student reader flows into the workbook. Does that make sense to everyone? Is everyone relatively clear on what the different components are? Mm-hmm. This isn't rocket science. I just want to make sure that you guys don't go back to your classrooms and be like, how do these different pieces fit together? What does that do?
Okay.
So
first is the student reader.
Was there a question?
Yeah, this first is student reader.
Uh-huh.
And then the student activity.
The student workbook.
The student workbook.
All of the activities are in the student workbook. Yeah. So let me just tell you a little bit. Again, we're going to dive into this and spend some time with it, but there are 17 chapters. So this is another thing we kind of have to think about. The idea is that you're going to be working on this with students in the spring semester. So to get through 17 chapters, you might want to think about what that schedule is going to look like. Now, I will say too that, and it says this in the instructor's guide, and we'll really emphasize this, that students can go through this process more than once. That's one of the reasons that having the online, the Word version of the student activities can be so great, because students can update them, they can fill them in, you can see changes over time. But we're starting in middle school. How many of you are in middle school context? Okay, how many are in high school? And then do we have any like 18 to 21? Okay, so the idea is that students are gonna get exposed to this over time. So you can kind of, over the course of the spring semester, we want you to be working through as many of these chapters and activities as possible, but it may be that you may spend more time on some that are going to be more meaningful for the students right now, because this is the first time that they're going through it. The 17 chapters are organized into three main sections. So we have section one, which is getting to know your IEP. So remember I mentioned that the very first thing that the instructor's guide prompts you to do is to get students access to their IEP or to at least the content of what would be on an IEP so that they can really start to understand and think about what are their strengths, what goals do they want for the future, what does that look like. So the lessons that are in section one are really all about teaching students those key terms. Now I know some of you are doing some of the I'm Determined materials and you've probably done other things. I know we introduced the Whose Future Is It Anyway process last year, the older version of this. So I know you've already been thinking about these things, but this section one really breaks down those key terms, you know, defining transition and what it is, you know, defining what it means to identify your strengths and weaknesses and really get students into that process. Section two focuses on how to teach students how to set decisions and go after goals with a specific focus on those transition domains that are really what we're highlighting. So employment, you know, what you want to do for education, rec leisure, all of those aspects. So you're going to see that. Section three has really been all about an actual IEP meeting and the process of communicating the goals that you set for yourself by going through section two. As we start flipping through the books, you'll see that in the student workbook, a lot of the activities really require students to write down things related to specific goals that they want to go after. You know, listing possible employment options, listing interests. So they're actually doing things that are going to enable them to be able to go through that process. So those are the three main sections, and the chapters are organized around them. The student reader, you'll see kind of in its layout and how it's designed, it was to the maximum degree possible kind of meant to be designed to be as student friendly as possible. We think it's a lot more friendly, the reader on that CD that the students can go through that will read the text aloud for them. But you'll see it's got pictures of kind of students. It's broken down. I know this is kind of tiny up here, but you can see it in your book. There tend to be a lot of places that pull out, like, what's a goal, defining words, using a lot of graphics. This is actually a circle that's introduced that students complete that talks about different people in their lives that they might invite to their IEP meeting that might be a part of that. So in many ways, a lot of the activities in here are probably things that you're already thinking about and talking about with students, but this puts it into kind of one process and framework that students can be organizing this information around. I'll open this up in just a minute to show you, but this is the student reader as it would look in the universally designed kind of online aspect. It's not online, just the CD version of it. So it's the same content, but you see the highlighted area, it will highlight the words as it's reading them to the students. You can set it up to either highlight each word or highlight sentences. And you know, the reason for that is you're getting the student to pay attention to the text as well as hearing it read aloud. The student can also navigate back and forth through the pages on their own and kind of reread things. It's got a lot of nice features built into it. So I'll show you how that works. And then after the student goes through the reader, this is just an example of some of the workbook activities. So here's a quick kind of getting started, asking the student to identify things they do know and don't know about the IEP process.
So for a middle schooler who has never gone to the IEP, how do they answer that?
Well, so that's going to be covered. It's linked to the actual curriculum. So the activities, that information is going to be covered. So they should be able to answer the questions, but I think what you'll find is that if you're doing this in middle school as an instructor and the facilitator of this, you're probably going to be providing more support for students because they haven't been introduced to these concepts yet. The other nice thing, especially with the multiple choice questions that are part of the reader, is that if you do it in the online, keep calling it online, I'm sorry, if you do it in the the CD, I'll just call it a CD, thank you. The software, yes. If you do it in that format, there are multiple choice questions that check understanding at the end, and if the student gets it wrong, it will then prompt them to answer it again. So it's a built-in feature, and you as the teacher can log in behind the scenes to see how the student is doing. So it will tell you the percent correct that the student's getting there. So you kind of know, is the student getting this? Are they not getting it? Do I need to go over those things? But that really is where, you know, we don't want to make this into a completely independent process. It's going to be important to look at your instructor's guide to know what each of the different chapters is focusing on. So you may do some pre-teaching around some of those words, and there may be a little bit more of that with your middle school groups versus your high school groups if some of the high school students have been exposed to the IEP a lot. Some of them may not have been. So it's going to be individualized to the students. Yeah.
What would you say is like the trajectory as far as like I have kids in eighth grade that are going to be doing this.
Mm-hmm.
Like how often? I don't know. Like are we supposed to get through this all of this school year? And then what does it look like in high school? I guess it's just especially because not my whole classroom is involved in this, and yeah. I have multiple. I mean, I have a lot going on. So it's like how much time am I devoting to this if they're going to go up to the high school and also the same bit? I'm just wondering.
Yeah, kind of the general recommendation, although, you know, general recommendations are always somewhat flexible, is we would like to see you be thinking about once a week doing one of the Who's Future lessons. And so you guys are also doing the SDLMI, and I love hearing the great stories about the things you're doing with that. So you're still also focusing on that, but once a week, and that's going to, again, kind of vary for your students. The chapters, as you'll see, are relatively brief. Some are longer than others. So it may be that you could get through one chapter a week, and so you could do almost all 17 lessons over the course of the spring. But if students need to break that up, if you want to do a chapter 1 week and then refresh on that chapter and do activities the next week, because activities can take some time and support, that would be fine too. I think that getting through, especially for the younger students, that first section of kind of getting to know what an IEP is and knowing that IEP is a really good goal if you want to spend a lot of time kind of targeting and doing those activities. And then, I mean, the idea too is, you know, communicating that you've done those activities so at the high school level or the next grade, they can emphasize the next one. So it's perfectly fine. I mean, it's the exciting thing about what's happening here is that we're thinking about longer periods of time. So, I mean, I think that you want to spend as much time as it takes to really feel like the student is able to master the content in those chapters. So we're not necessarily going to make you fill out a checkbox and say, I got through all 17. We want you to be integrating it into instruction about once a week at whatever speed or pace is going to be most effective for the students. Middle school, I think that may be slower.
Well,
but
yeah, it just looks different too. You know, because yes. It's not like being, you know, a whole, you have a whole class of 11 kids all working on it. So just make
yes.
it
so it's kind of more one-on-one.
Exactly.
That, yeah. And, but I'll say too that, for example, in kind of the 18 to 21 programs, it may be there that you're focusing on spending much more time diving more deeply into some of these aspects because you're really kind of wanting this to be something that lets you move forward in that trajectory. So it really is going to depend on the students. I would say, you know, over a student's high school experience, especially for those of you that are starting middle school, early high school, you know, getting them to go through this process in an in-depth way is a pretty important part of that. So whatever pace that takes. Great question. Thank you. And then the instructor's guide, as I kind of mentioned, this really is your tool that both gives you ideas about how to work back and forth between the reader and the workbook. It has kind of some of the vocabulary in there that you might want to pre-teach before a lesson. It does have some activities that you can do as a teacher that are not in the student workbook or the student reader. So especially once you get to that section 3 of kind of getting ready for the IEP meeting, it has some pretty good role-playing activities that you can use as a class or with students with some tips for how to do those, how to get students playing different roles, both kind of successful roles in the IEP meeting, not so successful roles. So check out that instructor's guide. I think it's really useful in that section, but it really does try to highlight and pull out for you the most important areas for the students to be working on. So let me show you, hopefully all the technology is going to work. Those of you that have seen me present before, I always worry about my technology. But I loaded Whose Future on here. And I hope the sound doesn't kill. So I've actually already logged in and set this up. I'm going to show you how you'll be able to set it up individually for each of your students. But you see, I've logged in and it's ready for me. If you had, say you're working with 5 students, what you'll do when you set this up initially is all of the students' names would be available on this drop-down menu. So the student would just find their name, and then they would know which chapters they've completed. It would have their individualized settings set up for it. And that's pretty easy to add. I'm also going to tell all of you a secret that I'm not probably supposed to tell you, but it's in your book. The password for everything is attainment. All lowercase, so write that down somewhere. It actually is in your instructor's guide, but you can change the password if you want to, but it's an easy thing to remember. Everywhere it asks for a password, it's going to be attainment.
Carrie, do you need the CD to actually run the program, or can we just install it and then the kids can just go on?
Okay. Exactly, yeah, the CD is not on my computer. I don't even have a CD thing. I have to plug something into the CD, so yeah, it's all on there. And it's the same with everything on your instructor's guide CD. Okay. You can just download all of that, so you don't actually have to have the CD. So now I'm going to log in, and it makes some nice noise. I don't know who picked the music.
Mike did.
But you'll see for this, I already went through chapter 1, so it's kind of grayed out or not as pronounced there. So if I wanted to do my next lesson, I can go back and redo chapter 1, but I'm ready to go on to chapter 2. And this will bring me, this is parallel, again, to what would be in your student reader, but you saw that it just read each of those aloud. And then, so after it reads that, the student clicks, and it automatically plays.
It is important for you to have certain people at your IEP.
So I have this set up for myself so that it's highlighting each word as it reads it. Again, you can change that, but that's what it is.
So
and so it's using advanced organizer feature. Each chapter is going to have kind of the initial outline and then a goal.
They are part of your education.
You can also turn on and off. Like, I've got it set up so that even though it hasn't read all of it, I can still click ahead and go to the next page. You can actually turn that off because sometimes, you know, you have students that aren't going to sit and listen through all of it. I know I'm very guilty of that and other things, but you can turn all of those things off. But, so a student can sit, you know, with headphones, or you can do this with a small group, and they can go through all of the content.
So at the end of this chapter, ask your teacher to help you get a copy of your most recent IEP.
So you see, here's where it's starting to ask the students to get a copy of their IEP. They're learning about who goes to the meeting.
Teachers almost always have to be there. They do a lot of work.
And this is where some of the terms, like it talks about a principal, vice principal, or diagnostician being there. So you may kind of provide some instruction to the student if you use different terms, if there's a different administrator that's typically there. So again, you have to put some of this in context sometimes for students, but it's written to be accessible as much as possible to the broadest audience. So, and the student can also see from down here, you know, the number of pages you have to go through. So you can always check in on a student to see where they are in that process. Does this seem like it could be helpful for some of the students you all are working with?
Sure.
Okay. Is this going to be an easy thing to set up in a lot of the classrooms? Do you have access to computers or other things that students are going to be
able to? A lot of kids have Chromebooks, which don't have CD-ROMs in them. So that
they don't have hard drives either, so I don't think even if you did put, like, attach a CD-ROM to the computer, it will stay because there's no
I know that we download, and it's not the same situation, but at the Beach Center, we have it on a shared drive so that multiple students can access it. So I don't know. So we could probably find out from technical support people how to do that. I'm not going to be able to help too much, but there probably is some solution to that. Now, I'm going to go ahead and just kind of quickly flip through and not have it read aloud. But here, for example, is that circle I was talking about and one of the other things. So it introduces the student to these areas. Their name goes in the center. And this will be something that's then in the workbook. So they'll have an activity to do where they're actually filling in the details of that. And I want to say, too, that many of the activities you'll find that you can always modify them or supplement them or use it in the context of something else. This is the quiz that's at the end. So this is just independent of the workbook and the activities. This is just a quick check to kind of make sure that the student's getting it, that we know what they're doing. So in this chapter, there's four questions. And so the student, should answer this. Who should come to your IEP meeting? Your favorite police officer, best friend, a famous pro athlete. Some of these I get frustrated with. What if the student happens to know a famous pro athlete? So they checked this, and you see that then they do have to click on my answer. So this is something for all of you to be aware of. When I was first playing with this, I was like, well, why isn't it doing anything? They do have to click on this. But then it will just round it out. It will read the question again. And, I mean, they can eventually go through it, as many times, and it will tell you until they get it. So if they next select the favorite police officer, it's going to do the same thing.
Who could come to your IEP meeting?
And then your best friend is going to be the correct answer. And it'll go on to the next one.
Right.
Now, again, some of these are a little bit of a challenge because what if they do know a police officer that they want to have come? But, it's trying to get at some of the content from the chapter and other pieces. But you may have to provide some context. Or it may be a good fodder for discussion. If, for example, in your community, police officers are really closely tied to a lot of your students, then you can talk through how that is an appropriate person to have involved. And that can go on the circle and be part of that activity, which is much more individualized for the students. But so this is basically what the online version is. So if I didn't complete all of my quiz, but I can still exit out, and then it will take me back. So you see there's a place there that's bookmarked, so I can go right back to the same place. So this is where if you do have students that's sitting through an entire chapter at one time, or if you really need to break it into a couple of weeks, or if you want to interrupt to do some instruction, you can do that, and it will take the student immediately back to where they are. So it kind of keeps track of where they are in their process in that program. And so all 17 lessons are included in here. And that's really what the CD version or the software version of this is all about. Now, it's not going to be up there generally when you're working through it. But you see, if I bring my cursor up to the top, I get some options here. So if you go to File, I am logged in right now as Carrie, and then I can go to the Options. Sorry, I know I'm standing in some people's way. But I have to, what's my password again? Attainment. Yes, it's password for everything. So that's then going to take you to a screen. So you guys, does everyone remember how I got there? I did the File, Options, put in the password. So right now, I'm the only person in here. You can also log in as a guest, as the teacher. So if I say myself, you can actually, if you go to Results, you can see I got a 70% on my quiz. And so that's going to be based on the fact that I didn't get that one question right on the first time. So it will tell you how the student's doing. So you know if they're missing some of these. You can, print this. You can do other things.
As a teacher, you can see all the students, or do you have to log in as them?
No, you can see all of them. Yep. And then also, so settings. So you'll see there's three different settings up here. Narration style. So actually, if the student doesn't want the narration, if they're going to be able to read it on their own, you can actually turn that narration off. It can be the natural speech or the word by word, which was what I did on. Also, you see there's different options for the highlighting, by word, by sentence, by line. You can also turn that off if that's not something that's useful for students, and even change the color. So, I mean, there's a lot of ways that you can individualize this.
So there's a setting for each student like that?
Mm-hmm.
That's wonderful.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. So each student's name will be up there, and there'll be that setting for each of them. Then here's this feature I mentioned, remember, on the story options, whether or not you want to turn on the auto page turn so that it will only turn the pages after the students heard all of it. So you can take off those clicker buttons if you're seeing that students are just going through it all the time. And again, this is just meant to give you options to individualize. You can also turn off the test. Let's say that you have students that have a lot of test anxiety and you'd rather just have them do the workbook activities. That's an option too. So you can individualize as much as you would like here. You can also take out content. So let's say that you just want the student to be working on the first chapter, or that you know you're only going to do the first five chapters, that's going to be your target for the semester. You can take the rest off so that it's not shown on the screen, so that the student doesn't think they have 17 to go through, so they're just seeing that. You can also, remember how on my screen it was just grayed out the chapter and it wasn't that clear? I mean, the graying function wasn't the strongest I've ever seen, but you can have it removed after the student's completed it. So again, it comes down to kind of distractibility and what works best for the students. And then there's finally just the system area. So you can actually set it up for students that use switches and other things if you want them to be able to use different switches to interact with the program. That's another technical thing. I can't tell you exactly how that works, but if you have switches that are integrated into the computer, you should be able to set it up in there and then use different scanning features and other things. So there's a lot of power built into this to really individualize it for your different students. And so if I wanted to add another student, just click on the add button. We can add Tony. Password again is attainment. As long as everyone leaves and remember, and you can actually set up different passwords for different students if you wanted to. I'm not sure why you would need to do that. I would just stick with attainment for everything. It makes everyone's life easier. And then you can even take a picture, so even this, even though I'm not Tony, I can take a picture of myself while I'm talking so that my mouth looks like I'm going, and then it will actually be there so that it pops up, and that's just a way to kind of give the student, you know, kind of that
resemblance.
Now, what's that called?
Yeah, so if we just click on add, so we can go through it again. So click on add, what's another student name we want to add?
John, I don't know.
And then we'll do attainment for his password. And then take another picture. You can pick one from a file if you're setting this up for all of your students and want to go out. Like I could go onto my computer and find like their class picture if I have that saved. Or you can do the snapshot. So you just have to make sure that the student was in front of your camera on the computer. Or you can choose to skip that and not do that. But so now we see from the drop-down menu that we've got John, Carrie, and Tony, and then also a guest so that you can log in and see those things as well.
So we log in as guests.
If you wanted to interact with the content, you can also log in as a student. It's just what you're trying to do. Does this look relatively user-friendly? Do all of you feel like you could go back and set this up and get it to do what you wanted it to do?
I like the reading feature a lot.
Again, that's one of the things that we're really kind of hoping helps make this something that's more useful.
So we have a lot of individual impairments, so if without that, it would be a one-on-one sitting there, so they can get it, and then that just gets monotonous.
Yeah, and, you know, hopefully, too, with having the PDF and the Word version of all of the workbook, too, they can at least use screen readers to go through those as well. And so then the quit button is up here, and I'm going to leave that screen, and I'm out of the program. So you do notice it does take up the entire screen, so you have to use the exit function. That's a universal design feature, so there's not all the distractibility of the other elements that are out there. All right. So I think what we'll do now is, I had all of this on a PowerPoint, and it's just in case. But what? Yeah, I'll send the PowerPoint to Terry so that it has a problem. Yeah, just, I didn't know if the software would actually work effectively or if I'd be able to use the computer, but since we did, that's easier. But, so I'm hoping that this is stimulating some ideas already for all of you. I know a lot of people are already chattering, so I'm hoping that's excitement about using it. But let's spend a little bit of time kind of thinking about going through all the elements. I set up here chapter 3, but you guys pick one of the chapters in that initial section on kind of getting to know your IEP. It could be chapter 3 or something else. At your table, start with the instructor's guide. See what the instructor's guide tells you about the chapter you selected. Then start looking through the student reader. You guys just have the paper version, unless some of you really high-tech people have already loaded the online version. But look at all of those things together. And I want you to think about what challenges you think you might encounter in using these with any of your students. I also want you to really think about a plan for what you might do as an instructor to support your students, and then what questions you have about using it. So take about 20 minutes, really go through that chapter, and we'll kind of wander around and help. Yes? There were some kind of questions or other things came up, but I'd like to just first have people kind of report out on what your initial thoughts were as you were going through the materials. Are there any questions or any kind of really exciting ideas that people had? Okay, let's start. Any questions?
I do have a question. I'm just struggling figuring out how we're going to do it with a severely disabled student, nonverbal,
with several tables. So I know that other people are struggling with this issue as well, and I know that we talked about and some people had some thoughts. So who would be willing to share something that they were thinking around that, and then I can give you some ideas too. Yeah. Sorry.
So I also had the same thought. I worked with another curriculum at and it is a lot of information, and some of my students are able to read it or read it aloud together. Or some of them, I take the chapters and take out the key points or the important vocabulary and I put it into Word Maker.
That's what I'm talking about. And even then, like for the kids who, that's even the struggle. They're literally working with a yes and no.
Yeah, so I think the Board Maker idea, and Terry, we were talking that, you know, with the same thing with the SDLMI, how we were kind of sharing and collecting examples of that, it might be really good if we could try to share some of the modifications that people are making, some common symbols that are being used for those things. I do think, too, we had a discussion about for students that are just kind of learning the yes-no and using that, that part of it is maybe pulling out a key concept from a chapter. So the example of, we looked at the circle that had all of the people that you could invite to the meeting or that are in a person's life. So you could use that, you know, do you want this person to be at your meeting, yes and no? So, I mean, it really is, and oh, sorry, go ahead, do you want to share?
I was just saying, real, everybody knows this, but, like, pictures of, like, the mom, pictures of dad, pictures of, you know, whatever, like, if there's two teachers that the student likes, maybe you could put both of them and then decide.
Yes. Yeah. And I was talking with this table up here, you guys are Providence, right? Yeah. About an idea, like with that circle as one example, you could do it with other chapters, but like you could print that out and actually hang that and leave that on the wall so that students can see those representations at multiple times so that you can link it back in other lessons. Like when you get to kind of the goal setting types of chapters, like you could talk about, well, who might you talk to from your circle about that. So people can make choices about who they want to talk to about something. Mm-hmm. So different things like that. I would say kind of in those circumstances, I wish we had, you know, kind of something that we could give you right away that was fully accessible to those students. As we all know, that doesn't happen as often as we would like it to. But start with the instructor's guide, because hopefully you saw that it's really brief. We, you know, the idea is not to overwhelm you with information, but it tells you the key concepts. So pick one of those and pull it out and have that be what you target with students that need a lot more support. And let's try to coordinate the same way with the SELMI, you know, sharing some of those symbols, because I think that will help everyone, because I know everyone's going to experience that in different ways.
Yeah, no, I was going, we share this through Terry, who will collect those examples and share them in some form. I just always feel the need to repeat, Mike talked about LeBron before, and one of the principles for kids who have really significant needs is the notion of maximal participation. Whatever they can do is what one should do. The mistake that people who don't understand that make is to assume that if they can't do it at is, then they can't do it and you stop, and the expectations get low. Hopefully nobody in this room has that flaw, for lack of a better way to say that. You know, and so the concept of just sort of remembering that you're sort of, and then the other key thing, which Angela talked about, Carrie talked about, the notion of thinking what the core concepts are and doing that in some modified way. I mean, if you think about all the curriculum things that many of you have done with us over the last 10, 20, 30 years, they've all been about identifying what the core ideas are and then figuring out how to utilize those in some form. So that's the real key. I mean, that's the real key. So.
Yeah. So that share, draw on each other, hopefully we'll be able to come up with a good resource. I was telling one of the other tables too that, you know, it will be really good to get that feedback, that we need that, that, you know, I know we were talking some about Chromebooks and other things and kind of the technology needs. I mean, even since 2011, we've advanced a lot. So this all provides good information to be able to say that we need to update these things and we need the resources to do that. So that's all helpful information. So yes, but thinking about what those core concepts are and sharing those for students with more severe disabilities will be a part of this process. What other issues or ideas or questions came up that people had? One of the other things that I heard from several tables was kind of questions about, you know, do we need to get through all 17 lessons? You know, how do we decide what to emphasize and all of those things? So I just kind of want to reiterate, I know we've talked about this a little bit, but the goal of this for the spring semester and the goal for all students, because students are going to be going through this over the course of their high school education. If you're working with, you know, the 20 and 21-year-olds, then, you know, you may need to kind of push into this a little bit more. But, you know, for those of you that are starting in middle school, early high school, emphasize, you know, based on the student's needs, their comprehension of the information, getting through as much content as seems reasonable for them to develop the meaningful understanding. You know, really that first section, section one, getting to know your IEP, is going to be really important for the younger students. So spend time there. If you are working with older students that have gone through that process already through another curriculum, you know, that goals and decisions section may be more useful for them. You may want to spend more of your time there. And then if you have a student that's going to be jumping right into their IEP meeting, you know, that third section of actually participating in that meeting is going to be important. So kind of as a teacher, you know your students, you know the context, kind of, you know, you're empowered to really make those decisions and make those modifications. So as you saw, you can turn on and off chapters if you just wanted students to be working on that goals and decisions section. I will say that over the course of kind of the students' high school and middle school experiences, we want them to be getting all of the content. And even if you decide to go through all 17 chapters, maybe you're focusing a little bit more on some activities than others. But then send that workbook on to the next teacher. Have that be a part of, you know, the student's portfolio or whatever's going forward, so that the next teacher can then emphasize some of those other activities or spend more time with them. So kind of think about this as a process in terms of what do the students need to understand, what do I want to target. They're not going to get everything out of this going through it this first time. I mean, none of us do. Think about it, you know, you read a book, you do something, you remember certain things, you can go back and do it again, and it's all new and different to you. So it's the same idea here. So it's not the end of the world if you don't get all 17 chapters done, but you know, have high expectations for yourself, for your students, but also make sure that it's meaningful and meaningful learning opportunities for them. And really take advantage of and use, you know, the CD features as they're helpful and useful to you to really let the students be engaging in that process.
I have a question actually for Tony. Yep. As the kids turn 14, will we be getting new student workbooks, or should we be making copies? So that...
See, I have more stuff to give you. I have garbage bags, so you can keep your stuff dry. And we have empty boxes if you'd like those.
I'll make copies if I have to.
Answer to that question is I really don't know. That as we sort of fund these things, they're sort of piecemeal, and the piecemeal goes year to year. Certainly you know that the commitment we have is for kids 14 to... 21, but that's probably a question that I can more accurately answer in the fall.
If we have funds,
we'll be glad to buy more workbooks. If we do not,
and
then...
I will say, too, that, so remember, too, from the CD in your instructor's guide, but you can, if you do want to print, if that's easier than making copies, everything's in there, and you can do those electronically as well, which then gives you the option of, you know, doing that multiple times with students. So that gives you one other at least option for that, other than the workbook. If that's a concern, and if that's an accessible format that might work for students.
Well, I can see, because we have all the 19 kids I have now, but as other kids turn 14, they'll be moved into this. So
yeah, see, we believe in this very strongly, obviously, and so we will promote whatever we can, and I'm usually pretty good at finding money for various things.
I just had a question. I don't know if you explained it before, but when they complete the assessments online and it gives you like their data, does that transfer on to the next teacher? Like if they're in middle school and they come to high school, can you access that?
That's a good question in terms of the quiz results.
Just so you know where they're at.
I doubt it. To be
it doesn't really live on a website anymore.
No, because it's mobile on your computer. Like, I mean, and that's even, like, if students are doing it on different computers, it's not going to transfer between computers.
But can you print the results?
You can print the results. So there was, and then put them in a share drive. Yeah, if you are doing it.
Say that the results in the document.
You could definitely do that. And if it's on a shared drive, you'd have to talk to your IT people about this, but I mean, if it's loaded and you're saving everything in a shared way, then I would assume everyone could see it. I just don't know if you've got, like, I don't know how many kids it's going to be able to manage. I honestly don't know that we've ever encountered that issue. So. But it's a good problem to have, and we can figure that out. But yeah, you can definitely print it. If you go in when you see the results, there were several different options, and one is to kind of download, one's to print, so you could track it and share it that way too. All right, so does this seem like a relatively straightforward? This is kind of something you can take and start using. Are people going to be able to do this after the first of the year, after you get back to classes?
We'll let you know.
All right. So does anyone have any idea right now? And I know Tony wants us to get going because I think there's another group coming in shortly. But does anyone have any ideas right now in terms of how you're actually going to integrate this either into a class or when you'll do this during the day with the students? I know some people that I talked to, you know, scheduling and figuring out how to fit this into the day is a problem. But what are some examples? Maybe we could have like a middle school example and a high school example of how you might fit this into the instructional day. Yeah.
My students are integrated into curriculum advisories, but they're doing a lot of PGI work, so they can come back and do this.
Okay, great. So during that advisory period then, they'll be able to, and do you anticipate them doing it individually? Hey, guys, let's listen to some, do you anticipate them doing it individually or as a group?
I would like to do a lot of it as a group.
Yep. Yep, yeah. I think that's great, and I share this idea with someone, I'm sorry, I can't remember who it is, I'm never very good at remembering those things, but the student workbook and the activities they're doing, it is nice if each student's doing that so that they kind of have a record so you can see that over time, but using those PDF and Word versions, you can still project those up on a screen and do that as a class activity where you're talking about that with the class as a whole, and then each student is kind of doing their own activity around that. All right, what about one more example, and then we'll call it a day.
We have like a RTI advisory period in the middle school, so my students, normally that's when they do like a social skills game or something, but I'll probably school my students like on a certain, we have 6 days to our schedule, which is like, you know, so convenient, so I'll probably pull them one of those 6 day rotations. Like, do it during
that. 6 days in a week.
In a 5 day week. Yeah. Well, no, so one goes in next.
It's Rhode
Island. It's all very confusing.
All right. I think that sounds like a good example. All right. Well, everyone, thank you for your time and attention today. I really hope these materials are helpful and useful. And thanks for all the work that you're doing. I know you've been doing a great job with the SCLMI in this, so we appreciate all the time and energy. And as always, let us know if you have any questions. Terry knows how to get in touch with us.